Happy Friday, everyone. All right, let's get started today. We got a lot to cover. Project 2 is due today, and very soon afterwards, either tonight or tomorrow, Project 3 will be released. And it's going to depend on things we're going to learn in class today, so it's very important. And you'll have like almost four weeks to work on this, which is a month. And if you're thinking, well, maybe I'll scare you on Monday, maybe I won't scare you now. I'll just tell you it takes 4 weeks. It does not take 1 week or 3 days before the deadline. That's how you end up, that's how people end up failing the class. All right. So, we've been talking about parsing, right? We've been talking about how, so what is parsing? Why are we talking about parsing? What does parsing mean? What is it?
Splitting it up.
Splitting one up. So what's the thing about inputs, outputs? What are the inputs? What kinds of tokens? Yeah, like a sequence of tokens, and what's the output? What are you trying to build? A parse tree, yes. Parsing generates a parse tree from the token, the sequence of inputs that we created with the lexer. Awesome. So we already kind of got a high-level idea of what parsing is, right? So we have kind of seen, okay, we have this, maybe this parse function, we have some context-free grammar, and in the parse-s function, we're going to get a token, we're going to check and figure out which one of these rules, because we have three possibilities. We have s can go to A, s can go to B, or s can go to C, right? And so based on that first token, we want to be able to decide which rule do we actually choose? And so we kind of briefly went over this. I'm going over this very generally to refresh your memory because we now need to build up some intuition and some additional functions that are going to help us actually calculate and to create these parsers given a grammar. So maybe some things we didn't think about. Check end of file. So after I parse A here in S, right? Why would I want to check end of file?
See if the stream is done.
See if the stream is done. Why? Because that's what we talked about.
No.
So why do we check for end of file?
Otherwise
it would keep going. Or let's think about this scenario where we have, I'm gonna steal this, see if this works. Boom, all right, cool. Let's think about the scenario where our input string is, let's say AB. And our grammar here, to refresh our memories. So this is our grammar. Oh, actually that works, that's weird. Okay, so this is our grammar. So first, self-check, is this string in this grammar? Can this grammar ever produce this string?
Yeah.
Yeah? So which production rules? Creating derivation. So let's start with the S. Which rule do you want to choose? S goes to A?
Yes.
Okay, and then which derivation rule?
A
goes to small a. Are these strings the same? So is this a derivation of this string? All right, let's try again. How do I derive this string? Take B. So we go to B. And then which rule do you want me to choose? So let's say I choose B goes to little b. It's going to be little b. If instead I choose the second, maybe the first one here, big b, little b, I need to choose b again, so I choose b. So can I ever derive this string ab? No, it's not valid syntax, right? The grammar says, so somebody, what does this grammar say? Like how we did with regular expressions, right? We tried to express in English what these strings look like that are in this regular expression. Or sorry, in this context-free grammar. So what are the strings that are in that this context-free grammar can produce? Does anyone want to tell me one? What was it?
Single A.
A single A. From this rule, S goes to A, and then A goes to little a, right? So a single A, what else?
A single B.
A single B? Well, one or more B's, right? One or more B's, what about?
Zero
or more C's? Yeah, you can think about one or more C's or the empty string, epsilon. So those are the strings. So the string AB is not in any of those, right? It's not possible for this context-free grammar to generate this string. So then let's step through what happens here for parse S. All right, so this is our input, right? So we're parsing, we haven't consumed any tokens, any input. We call ttype equals get token. What's it gonna return?
Small a.
Small a, right? So remember now we're talking about terminals and non-terminals. So get token is gonna return a terminal, in this case, a, b, or c, or I guess any other character. So it's going to return A, so T type is A, so we say, is A equal to A? Yes, just say yes. Or just don't say yes, believe it in your heart of hearts. A is equal to A. And then we call unGetToken, so we put it back. So we first call getToken, so now we move the input here. And then we call unGetToken, so we put it back here. We call parseA, let's go steal the source code of parseA. Oh, I don't have it. Okay, cool. So we already did that last time. So we called parse A. So what's going to happen to the stream after this point? Yeah, so it's going to consume that A and check and make sure, yes, A is produced here. So when it returns, it's going to be here. So if we just stopped and said, okay, great, parse A returned. That means that there was no syntax error in parse A. We're all good. But we know we're not good. We know this is an invalid syntax, right? The string cannot be, we cannot create a parse tree given this grammar of this string. So now we want to check. So what would check end of file look like? If you were going to write this. Yeah, some T type. Get token and then what? Well, maybe let's flip it around a little bit. If it's not equal to, what do we use, dollar sign, right? To specify end of file, then what? Error, yeah, syntax error. So let's assume we have a function, syntax error. We know, hey, there should not be an end of file. There should only be end of file. If there's anything else other than an end of file character, then we know it's a syntax error. And we can say that the syntax error halts, stops execution. And so now we're good. So now we're actually going to correctly say that this is a syntax error, as opposed to just this string. Right? Similar things happen. We say ttype equals get token. We say A. So here we say A. We check here. We say unget token. So we're going to move back. Then we say parse A. Parse A is going to be here. We're going to go into check end of file, we're going to check and say yes, that's end of file, and so that means we're good, and this string is actually in our language. All right. So this is where we want to go. The question is, how can we actually do all of this? So to do that, we have to build up some examples. So, and we saw last time, right, that we saw here that I can check based on looking at the very next token, right? I can peek ahead and look ahead one token, and I can decide, is it this parse A, is it this parse B, or this parse C? So why could I do that? What was that?
Each of them begins with a different alphabet.
Yes, A, B, and C, all strings that they could possibly produce start start with a different token or character in this sense. So, what we really want to be able to understand, so let's think about a different, let's say I switch this language around, and I say B goes to ABB, something like that. Now, by looking at one character ahead, can I tell? No, I'm in parse S, I read an A, do I know if S goes to A or S goes to B? No, because they each can generate a string that starts with the same character. So, to help us out, we need to write a function, or we need to, well, we're going to study the algorithms for how to do this, but I want us to do this and develop this because it's not terribly complicated. We want some function, let's call it first. Let's spell first, right? Wait, why can't I spell first? F-I-R-S-T, is that? I'm having a huge brain moment. All right. There we go. Perfect. All right. So I have a function. It's going to take in what we'll call, let's do, what do we do? Alpha? Is that alpha? Any Greek in the audience? I'm not super good at my, that is alpha, right? With lowercase alpha? Cool. Okay, we'll say it takes an alpha, where alpha is a sequence of terminals and non-terminals. Right, so thinking about first as a function, so it takes in a list or a sequence of terminals and non-terminals, and it's going to return a set of what? So what do we want this function to represent? So let's think about it like this. Let's get change this back to here. So I want the first of A to be the set containing A. And so what is the first of B then? Big B? Little B? So then what would be the first of C? Epsilon or what?
C, small c.
C, epsilon. Right? So what I want is, I want to know, given a sequence of terminals and non-terminals, all possible strings that that sequence can generate, what's the first thing that those strings could start with? And we know that eventually when we do these derivations, right, we're going to get a sequence of terminals, right, concatenated together. So it only makes sense to talk about terminals. So if you think about type checking, we should never see non-terminals in this set. So there should be a set of non-terminals, or just terminals. And epsilon. But this is a little tricky, right? Are we ever going to read epsilon from get token? Is get token ever going to read epsilon? What is it going to read? What does get token return? Tokens, yes. And what else? Which are what in our context-free grammar? Terminals. And what else? What else could it return?
End of file.
End of file, yes. It can also return end of file. So it's only, get token can only return a terminal or end of file. But our first sets can have terminals and epsilons. So we'll figure out how we can deal with that later. So this is at a high level. So we think about, this is actually a lot of times the way I like to think about code is, okay, let's think about this function. What's the input to this function, and what's the output of this function? Right? And then we can talk about how to actually write this function. But if you start with that basic building block, everything else becomes a lot more clear and a lot easier. So let's. So I said alpha can be a sequence of terminals and non-terminals. So if I say, let's say that I have first of lowercase a. What would that be?
Just A.
Yeah, just A, right? This makes sense, right? I mean, it's literally, there's no rules, there's no derivation. It's a terminal. So that means that all possible strings that generate from there is going to be a terminal. Let's think about this. Does that logic change if I add an arbitrary number, if I concatenate an arbitrary sequence of terminals and non-terminals after it? So think about it in concrete terms. Let's say, what's the first of like A, B, A, B? A or what, more precisely? Small a is more precise. More precise than that. Is this correct? Let's think about it this way. The set containing A, yeah. We're thinking about sets, right? So this is the set containing A. Awesome. So then, any arbitrary. So would this change if I change this B to a capital B?
No.
Or if I change this B to a capital B or this A to a capital A? No, because for this sequence of terminals and non-terminals, doesn't matter what happens after that first A. Every possible string is going to start with this lowercase a. So then, what would be the first of A concatenated with any number of sequence of terminals and non-terminals? What would it? Sorry.
Set containing A.
Set containing A. Yep. Perfect. Right. Cool. We're deriving rules. All right. What about epsilon? The set containing epsilon, right? Because we want, we already said we want terminals and epsilons in here. Just like up here, when we said the first of C is C or epsilon. Okay. Cool. All right, so let's put this to work a little bit. So we have S goes to A or B. A goes to little a, B. B goes to little b, B or epsilon. So then I said, what are the first sets of all this S, A? So let's say, the first set of A. This is going to be the second thing A. Perfect. And B. B, why'd you say or epsilon? What was that? How many rules are there for B?
Two.
Right, so actually what are we doing? So we're saying the first of B is really the first of each of the rules, right? Little b, big B, union with the first of epsilon. So this is, so what do we say the first of a terminal, something starting with a terminal? Little b, union with what?
Epsilon.
Epsilon. Cool. If you think about this, it's actually a really powerful function we're writing, right? Because we're able, using this, to tell something about all possible strings that are going to be generated by this context-free grammar. So let's carry this a little bit forward a little bit more, too. What's the first of S? Second containing one element,
a.
Little a, little b,
epsilon,
right? So isn't that pretty cool? So these are, this context-free grammar generates infinite number of strings, but we're able to very easily, well, in this case, very easily tell, but we'll actually see that we'll develop an algorithm that can run on any context-free grammar, and it can tell you precisely for every non-terminal in this language, and any sequence of terminals and non-terminals, what all possible strings that can be generated, what they start with. Right? That's something that's pretty cool. And then we'll see how that comes into play later on.
Okay. So what about this? Let's make it a little bit more complicated. So I have some rules here, right? In some sense. I have a rule here. So let's say, you can say these are the same rules, right? Anything that starts with a terminal, the first set is that thing, right? I have another rule here about epsilons, right? Okay. And here, right, I kind of have a rule about what to do, and actually even here, right, that's weird. Fancy pens, all right. Here I have a rule about what to do when I have ORs, right, when I have two different rules. Right, so the first of B is going to be the first of whatever that rule is, union with the first of any other rules that B has. Okay.
Is there a name for those things on the right-hand side of the mapping? So we have the non-terminals, and then we have the interesting collection of other terminals and non-terminals that non-terminal maps to.
Here? This would be, each of these are rules, production rules. So you have, I actually like to think of it as left-hand side and the right-hand side. So the left-hand side, you have one non-terminal, and on the right-hand side, you have an alpha, which is a sequence of terminals and non-terminals, or epsilon.
So the first set of a non-terminal with several other non-terminals on its right-hand side would be the union of the first sets of each of the non-terminals in the right-hand side.
Yes. We'll dig into that more, trust me. We're going to especially dig into this more, so preview project 3, you're going to be writing code that does this. So when you're writing a program that takes in a context-free grammar like this and spits out first sets of any arbitrary grammar. So it's super cool. So we're learning here. Right now we're building up intuition. I can give you the formal rules, but I find that if you actually understand why these rules work, you'll apply them a lot better and be able to think about how to write a program that does this as well. Okay, let's make it a little bit more complicated. So I have S goes to A. A goes to B. B goes to, what do you guys want? The little b, big b. Right. So let's say I go in the same order I went before. So what's the first of S? What was that? Small b? So how do you get there? Think about your thinking about how you actually arrive to that small b. You're trying to break it down into kind of an algorithm or some kind of explanation. Someone? What was that?
First of A.
Yeah, so the first of S is really, but why A? Yeah, so we kind of said it's like first of what's on the right-hand side here. So we could say first of A, right? But do we know what first of A is? No, we don't know. Yeah, but we know, so if we look at and we try to do first of A, it's the same, I'm just gonna use an F for right now. First of B. But what do I know about first of B? Yeah, the second containing B. And now if I revisited the first of A, would I know what to put here? Yeah. And if I did this for first of S? So what is first of A now? Second containing little b. So at this point, you might be thinking, ooh, beautiful recursive algorithm, right? Or to calculate the first of S, I need to calculate the first of A. To calculate the first of A, I need to calculate the first of B. So let me right now dissuade you of thinking that way, because you will run into problems if you program things this way. So let me show you an example. New context-free grammar. S goes to A. A goes to say S or B, B goes to little b. So, right, is it, so first thing you gotta ask, is this a valid context-free grammar?
Yes.
Why the question?
It starts with a non-terminal, it ends with a non-terminal, or a terminal, and it's got a bunch of other stuff in between.
Yeah, right, so all we said, really, is the left-hand side of the rule must be a non-terminal and a non-terminal by itself. You have the production, the arrow symbol, and then an alpha of any sequence of terminals and non-terminals. Right? And we know that this bar is just shorthand for another rule that says A produces B. So then why the question? I understand the question. I just want you to think about why. Why is it weird or different than what we've seen before?
Get stuck in infinite loops.
It gets stuck in an infinite loop, or you get stuck in an infinite loop thinking about it. Yeah, but it doesn't break any of the context-free grammar rules, right? We just said we can do anything here. And S is only important because we know that all trees must start with S, and all derivations must start with S, but we didn't give any restrictions to say that S can't appear during the derivation. Right, so in this example, valid derivation would be S, A, S, B, and then a little b, right? This is a totally valid derivation. Pop quiz, is this ambiguous grammar? Oh, you guys really looked up at that. Should say that more often.
Doesn't S need to go to A before it goes to B?
Yes. So is this ambiguous?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Why?
Is there two parse trees that can generate the same string?
Yeah. And how many parse trees are there that can generate the same string?
Crap.
Yes. I think an infinite it would be a probably more apt, well, maybe not more apt, but more polite description, I guess. Cool. Okay. But it doesn't matter that it's ambiguous. We can still define first sets for these. So let's think about this. So first, okay, let's think about kind of like we were doing before, right? So we said first of S is the same as first of A. And first of A is going to be the union of first of S union with the first of B. And if I was writing this recursively, I would do first of S is the first of A is the first of A, first of S, first of S, first of A, first of A. And I get into an infinitely recursive loop, and I would run out of stack space eventually and crash. So, this is the way we break that loop. Usually what we care about is we care about, right, at least right now, we're going to care about what is the first set of the non-terminals in the grammar. And this is going to help us in parsing, right? I tried to give you a little flavor of that, because when we have different rules, we can actually distinguish between them based on the first sets. So, what I'm gonna do is before I even try to start thinking about first sets, I'm going to assume that they're all empty set. So I said the first of S is empty, the first of A is empty, the first of B is empty. So this is my step zero. I'm gonna say they're all empty sets. Now, I'm going to say, okay, what's the first of S? What do I know based on what I've thought about these rules? Yeah, the first of A. What's the first of A? No. What is the first of A? We have it right here. Empty set. Yeah. So I say, okay, it's the empty set. So I do one step and I say, great, it's the empty set. Now for first of A, I try to calculate first of A. So what's the first of A? First of S union with the first of B. So what's the first of S?
Empty
set. What's the first of B?
Empty set.
Empty set. Great. Okay, what's the first of B? Small b. So then what's, like, yeah. So this would be the second containing B. Now, because I've changed something, I need to do this again. Right? Before, when I first set things up, you can think about it, step zero, they're all empty sets. But when I started to go through and try to calculate each of the non-terminals here, I made a change. I added something to one of these sets. So now I gotta start again using, let's see, I didn't give myself enough room. A, B. So I'm gonna start again using empty set, B. Cool. So then I start with S again, and I say, the first of S is what based on this? The N is the first of A, which is empty set. Yeah, nothing changes here. Now when I go to the first of A, what's the first of A? First of S union with, and the first of S we know is empty set, and the first of B is second chain B. So union those together, and we have the second chain B. We do this one more time for B, and we see that B also is the second chain B. So did I make a change?
Yes,
so I gotta do it again, one more time. Well, maybe not one more time, I don't know. So now I see the first of S is what? First of A, which is the second thing in B. I just calculated that right here. I'll do this, S union with B, the first of S is the second thing in B. The first of B is the second thing in B. So I can say it is the second thing in B, right? Sets. Number doesn't matter. If you have the set containing B, union with the set containing B, you have the set containing B. Cool, we do it again for B. Am I done?
No,
I made a change. I need to do it one more time. So I do it one more time, and I would find that it's all the same.
So is it like it's gone?
Sweet. So I go through one more time here, set containing B, set containing B, and I say, did I make a change? No, so then I stop. So you can think about, I keep applying these rules that we're going to come up with for first sets. I keep applying them until I make no changes, right? So you can think about, you start in a state where you're assuming that they're all empty sets. Then every time you go through those rules, you try to add more information to what you know. So in the first step here, we found out, oh, the first of B is lowercase b. Great. Then I do it one more time, and I go, oh, now the first of A is the second contained lowercase b. And then I do it one more time, and I find out the first of S is b, but I apply all my rules one more time, and I said, ah, that didn't give me any new information, therefore, I don't have to keep applying these rules, right? Because all of our first set rules depended on the other first sets. Yeah?
So what we just went through is a way to get first sets with only terminals in them, without going into some freaky infinite loop.
Yes.
Like, and it, regardless of the context-free grammar, it doesn't matter what grammar we're working on, we can always get a first set with terminals without.
Yep. You assume that they're all empty sets, and then you work from there. Cool. Yeah.
So in the step number two, so when we are calculating first of A.
Yes.
So first of A is first of S.
Yes.
So is it the previous step S or the upper S?
Actually, technically, either way will work, I believe, because you've already made a change, but really you should use the latest value that you have of S. Exactly, yeah, because you just calculated it, right? It's never going, it may change in that we add more things, but we never take things away. So you can always use the latest value you have when calculating first sets. Exactly. Cool. So, if we never, so actually, now that I think about it, yeah, what we have right here, this is enough for you to do, I think like 60%, well, less than that. Of the first set calculations of Project 3, it's enough to do about 50%. Because we didn't really talk about what to do with epsilon, so let's think about how that changes things. So, I have a new grammar, S goes to A, B. I have A goes to little a, B goes to little b. So using what we just did, so could we calculate the first sets here for S, A, and B? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, so let's think about what's first of S. Or actually, let's start with A and B. Those are a lot easier, right? So A is what? Little a, and B is little b. Great. And so first of S is what? It's the empty set? Well, first time through. Well, it's like, what should it be? Intuition without calculating and just looking at it. It should be small a?
Yes.
Why?
S derives first of a. S derives a, so it should derive.
Yeah, so when we're doing first, right? We have first of S is equal to the first of the right-hand side. So here we have first of AB. Right, do we actually talk about what to do in this situation? But what should we do?
First of A and multiply by first B. We don't care about B because that's a concatenation.
Yeah, we only care about the first character, right?
The first non-terminal or terminal, depending upon what it is.
Yeah, so it's going to be, we saw that in a terminal it makes sense, right? And so here we have the first of S is really the first of just A. Which would be the second containing A. So this makes sense, right? Because this is essentially concatenation. We have S produces A, B, right? So if you think about all the possible strings that S can generate, right, like my cool squiggly line trees, right? Whatever the first character, what they generate, is going to be the first, all strings that A can possibly generate, the first character of those strings. Okay. Seem pretty straightforward? Yeah.
How come we don't have like three columns worth of information?
How come we don't have what?
Three columns worth of information. So because like the first one would be like an empty set.
Oh, it would be. We were just going through, not calculating, but thinking about it and just looking at it. Yeah, this is more building up intuition time, not calculation time.
Gotcha.
But we definitely would. We'd have to go through all those steps to figure it out. Cool. So, yes. Please.
What if A is epsilon in that case?
Good question. Reading my mind. So first thing to ask yourself is A, does this change things? And B, how? And C, why? So does it change things?
Yes.
Yes. It does? Why? Or I guess how, let's go how first. So how would this change maybe the first sets, like intuition base?
Because now, when we derive S, A can be epsilon, so the first set of S will be the first character of B.
Yeah, so, okay, good. Okay, so first, how would this change, will this change the first set of B?
No.
No, will it change the first set of A?
Yes,
based on the rules we already talked about. Awesome. Now, what about the first set of S?
Yes.
How?
A, B.
Epsilon?
No, not at all.
Why not?
Because
epsilon can have B.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's talk about why this changes things. So now I still have this same thing as here, right? I have first of S is the same as first of A, B, right? The sequence A, B. But can I make that simplification of this is the same thing as first of A? Why not? Because A could go to nothing, right? Thinking about the tree again, we have the tree of A, B, and all possible strings that S generates, right? We care about, it's not really a tree. That that's better here. Right? We care about what's the first character that all S's could possibly generate. Right? And so in one scenario, if A does not go to epsilon, then we have the first of A. Right? A is going to generate a bunch of strings. And in some scenario where A is not epsilon, we need that first set. Whatever A can generate. But in the case that A goes to nothing, then what do we care about? Right? So this goes to absolutely nothing, an empty string, and so now the first of whatever S produces is going to be the first of what B can produce. Okay. So let's think about it. So let's try to put that into maybe a kind of rule. So we have first of S, and we have first of, let's call it A alpha, right? So A, non-terminal, different from our other rule of little a of a terminal. So here we have first of S is the first of non-terminal A and alpha. So we know one thing, right? We already said, well, it's definitely at least going to be the first of A, right? Almost, though. Is that true? Did that apply here in this case? Sorry, here in this case? Why? What's wrong? What didn't we include from first of A and first of S? Yeah, in case of A goes to epsilon. So you can think about looking just at this first character here, right? I know that, okay, in the case that A does not go to epsilon, then S will have, could possibly start with all the first characters of A minus epsilon. Everybody agree? I'm not saying it's the only rule. I'm saying this is one rule we can apply. Yeah.
What if absolute, alpha is also absolute?
Yeah. We'll get into that. Yeah, don't worry. It's coming. I like it. All right. So now we have. Okay, cool. So, what does this mean? So, the first of S we want to see is in some form of first of A, A alpha, and epsilon is in the first of A. So what does this mean we should add to the first of S? The first of what? So let's say this took care of the case, right? So this will still apply. So it'll be first of A minus epsilon, but what else should we do?
Union of the first of B.
Yeah, we want the first of, well in this case, in the previous example we used B, but here we need the first of whatever comes after A. Right? And so this alpha can be a sequence of terminals, non-terminals. So if it's a terminal, the first rule applies. If it's epsilon, the second rule applies. If it's another non-terminal, then these rules will apply. And I'm saying equal here, this is really kind of like a union thing. We're adding to our knowledge of what first of S is. So it's okay, so let's play with this a little bit. So using these rules, let's see. Okay. So we start out with an empty set of first of S. A, first of A, I suppose I should put these in F of B. start out with empty sets. So let's start with B first, because I don't want this to take forever.
Why does B start with an empty set?
Huh?
So why does B start with an empty set?
Why does B? Oh, it would. I'm just, because we would think about programmatically, start everything in empty sets. So you don't, you assume no knowledge of what the rules are, and then you go through each of the rules.
Gotcha.
So if I just start with B, what's the first set of B? Little B. Awesome. First set of A. So how do I handle this recursion here? First of A is the first of A union with the first of epsilon. What do I use as the first of A?
Empty set.
Empty set, because that's what I know the first of A is, right? It's the empty set union with, what's the first of epsilon?
Epsilon.
Epsilon. Awesome. And now when I do first of S, so by, let's say this rule 3 right here, and let's say this is rule 4. So by rule 3 here, I have the first of S is what? First of capital A, but what? Minus what? Minus epsilon. So it's going to be what?
Empty
set. Okay, great. And then what is, so empty set. And then I union that with, what's the first of S for this rule? So what does this say? Yeah, so this is going to be, well, in this case, the first of S is going to be the first of little a, big B, which is, we know from the other rule, is the second containing little a. Do I go then look at the first of big B?
No,
because a, little a does not have an epsilon in its first set, right? The first set of little a is little a. That was our first thing. So this and here does not apply, right? It's also not a non-terminal. That's also why this and could not apply. Okay, one more scenario. Oh. AB, A goes to A or epsilon, B goes to B or epsilon. Now you can have B's here, or A's here, whatever. Cool. Okay, so I want first sets of S, of A, of B. So I'm starting them off with all empty sets. Let's start from the top down. So the first of S would be what? The first of A minus epsilon. Which is what? The first of A is empty set, so it's the empty set. Okay. First of A is little a. And what else? And epsilon, awesome. And B is little b and epsilon. Did I make a change?
Yes.
Okay, go through it again. So S. S goes to capital A, B. So what do I add first? First of A minus epsilon, which is the which is A. And then what do I add? First of B. So first of B. I have the first of B minus epsilon, which is B. But is this correct? Why not? Yeah, so that, what does that mean about S, if B can have epsilon too?
S can start with an
epsilon. S can also produce an epsilon, exactly. It can start with an epsilon. Right? So, epsilon. But how did we get there, right? So none of our other previous four rules applied, right? The third rule said, always take the first of that thing and add it minus epsilon. The fourth rule basically told us when we can move on to the rest if the first non-terminal in our sequence had epsilon in its first set. But we don't have a rule of what happens if you get to the end and it was all epsilons. Right? We can see here by intuition, there is a possibility that both A is going to go to epsilon and B is going to go to epsilon, which means that S can also go to epsilon. So we need a fifth rule. that says something to the effect of the first of S is equal to, well, the set containing epsilon, if what? Yeah, so every, so if, let's say for the rule S goes to alpha, right? For every, let's call it, I don't have a good symbol for this. What? Let me know.
Intersection bending is alpha.
Yeah, so for every, like if I was writing code, I'd say like for all, well not code, but like for math, for all, let's say A in epsilon, or in alpha, let's see, how do I want to phrase this? Epsilon exists in the first of A, right? Then we add epsilon to S's first set.
Say that one more time.
So this would be if, so we have, so the rule is in the form S goes to alpha. So here alpha means the entire right-hand side of the rule. So we're not pulling out, in some sense, the first character like we did before with A alpha or little a alpha. Here we're saying the entire sequence of terminals and non-terminals, if for all A in that sequence, epsilon exists in the first set of A, then you add epsilon to the first of S. And really, when you're looking at it, you say, okay, is epsilon here? Yes. Is epsilon here? Yes. Then I add epsilon to the first of S. Cool. And wait, just a second. We've just derived all five of these rules. Pretty sweet, right?